Hey everybody, thanks for coming. I had this idea to present you what types of outputs, of modern outputs you can obtain from data. So I will show you today how you can generate modern online help and quality PDFs from data content. Does anybody of you not know what data is? So, is the font good for you? Should I increase it more, or is it okay? I have my data map on the right with data topics, and usually for generating output from data, there is a publishing engine called the Data Open Toolkit, and it comes with minimal support for generating HTML documents. So using the Data Open Toolkit, you generate a very simple HTML output from data, and so it has a table of contents, topics, and so on. We created our own Oxygen plugin for the Data Open Toolkit, which generates web help output. Welcome, and I will show you some of its features. Because you may not, even if you use our web help output, you may not use all of our features. So in the Oxygen configure transformation scenarios, you can choose to use data map web help responsive or web help responsive with feedback, and I will talk about this later on. So we'll generate some web help responsive from data content and talk about what it looks like and what it can do. So this is our web help responsive output. It's HTML and JavaScript. It doesn't have any ActiveX components or Java applets and so on, which means that it works well in a variety of web browsers. And we have a compatibility section on our website stating the list of web browsers which are compatible with our web help output. It's Edge, Internet Explorer, Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Opera, and so on. Internet Explorer meaning version 10 or newer. What else does this do? It's responsive to the screen size. So it has a main menu on top showing you the top level in your data map. And in each menu we have a sub-menu containing the subtopics. It has a search area, and as cards it shows you the topics on the first level in the data map. If you have a smaller screen, as the screen narrows down, you see the cards start going on the next line, making room. And at some point the menu on top will disappear and it will get replaced with this drop down menu, just in order not to take up more space. So you can use this web help output both for desktop applications or editing in visualizing in the desktop web browser on your mobile phone, and it should behave quite well. The search is by default offline, so when you type keys and search, Oxygen doesn't go to the Google search engine in order to return results, for example. It's based on a database we create, a JavaScript database created next to the generated HTML files, which means that you can take these HTMLs and JavaScripts and use them locally in your own application. As I'm typing in the search field, I will get a drop down here showing me various keywords selected gathered from the data map, and even short descriptions and so on. So this drop down may help me find the keywords that I want to be searching for. The search also supports Boolean operators like AND, if I want to search both for autumn and flowers. The OR operator is supported by default, so searching for autumn OR flowers is as if searching for autumn flowers. Or it also supports quotes if you want to find some consecutive words and narrow down the search. What are the features that it have? As it shows me the search results, it has a rating here showing me how much confidence I should have in the returned result. And this rating is based on where in the topic the search words were found. For example, if I go to autumn flowers, I can see that the search words are in the title. It means that they have a higher search rating than usual. But you can increase the search rating by adding extra keywords to the data topic. So in a data topic, I can add a prologue section, and in the prologue I can add some keywords. And I can add maybe a keyword like I don't know, something like winter maybe, so maybe close to winter. So the keywords that I add will be indexed by the search engine, and they will have high priority because I have defined them as keywords. And also what I'm doing is I'm creating aliases for some other keywords, because you may have products which are named in a certain way, but the end user searches for them in a slightly different way. You have synonyms, so you can define aliases. And once I define this alias and I regenerate, I can search by using this alias word.
Can this alias be fed by the terminology database?
You would somehow need to create these keyword sections in the topics, or maybe have keywords have a content reference to some other place where you would define all these keywords from different topics.
Okay.
So I search for this keyword. The keyword doesn't appear anywhere in the topic because it was in the prologue section, which doesn't show up, but it helped me increase the rating of that certain word, so that when people search for it, they will find autumn flowers. When you search and find something, you have these highlights here showing you the search words as hello.
Hello,
please join us. No problem. So after I'm searching, the search results are highlighted in the topic, and we have a topic in our user's manual describing the search engine and how you can search, like quoted search, search for consecutive words, Boolean search. Also, if you define an index term in a topic, it has higher search ranking. Talking about index terms, so in each topic you can define index terms. Prologue, index term. Index term. Oh, it's called index terms, I think. So you can define index terms. Somehow I forgot how to define. Let's search for an already existing index term. So here's how you define index terms, either in the metadata section or in the topic content. And once you define such index terms, they can the web help output will create a particular index page for them. So you have this, and it has an index page, and it shows up all your index terms grouped by the letter with which they appear in the data content, and they have links taking you to the topics. The side table of contents. Let's say I have a data topic, and I add a couple of sections to it. I have first section and first section content, and maybe a second section and the second section content. And let's publish to Web Help and see how that looks like in the table of contents. So after the initial Web Help screen, which shows this card type layout, and here it shows the show descriptions. So this is in a way important to add show descriptions to your data topics. They show up in the Web Help in these cards. If I go to a topic, I will have this this separate smaller table of contents on the right of the topic, and this shows me all the sections defined in the topic with links to them. For larger topics, you have the larger table of contents showing me the child elements of this particular topic. But if the topic would have also sections, you would have again the section table of contents on the right. So you have basically two table of contents, one showing you the children and the siblings of the current topic, and one showing you the sections in the current topic. What else can you do with the sections? If you zoom in, you have folding, so you can fold the sections in the published output. And you can get links to them. So you click the link here, and then you go to the here, and you see that I have the link to the section that I can, you know, copy and then paste in an email and maybe send somebody.
A question about
yes.
About this what you call folding, so
mm-hmm.
collapsing, expanding of sections. Is it also something which you can do with the fig element figures?
Let's try it out. It should work.
Okay.
So this should also apply for figures. So let's insert the fig element with the title and decide it maybe insert an image. Did I properly know? So the no, sorry. The image should be inside the figure. So I have a title figure. I would also add a table maybe. After the paragraph. And we'll see how this looks like in the published output. We should do this maybe for most of data elements which have a title, meaning sections, figures, and tables. It seems that we don't do this for figure, so I could maybe add an issue for this.
Yeah.
But we do it for table.
Okay.
Okay. I will just add an issue to the end of my presentation.
Thank you.
because it makes sense they have a title. At least when they have a title, they can be used like this. Code blocks. So what are code blocks? You sometimes need to add code fragments in your, you know, publication. Like maybe this is a CSS code that I want to present to the end users and say, if you are, you're writing CSS, you should write it like this, like section, font size, 20 pixels, maybe color red. So I wrote a small CSS fragment here. I will set the output class attribute with value language minus CSS, and we'll see how this will look like in the published output. We usually, in our users manual, we use a lot of XML examples and CSS, so so this is the code block. As you see, it has CSS like syntax highlight because I have set the output class language CSS on it. And what else you can do with the code block? You have this copy marker here. You copy it to the clipboard and then the end user can paste it in their own small example that they are building. What other syntax highlight support we have for code blocks besides CSS? It's C, C++, C#, CSS, ini files, Java, JavaScript. I added JSON some time ago, Perl, PHP, SQL, XML. So this might be handy for you if you give small snippets of code to the end user. You may have track changes in your data content. Maybe enable track changes, have some insertions, and maybe some deletions, or maybe add some comments in certain areas. So once you have HTML content with track changes, by default the track changes will not appear in the published output, so the topic will look like the original topic, but you may want to force the track changes to appear in the published output, and we have a special parameter for this called the web help show changes and comments, and you can set it to yes and publish. And then the reviewer may also see all the other reviews made by other people to the published HTML output. So you see, now you have for the insertion, you have the side views, side callouts, which are floating, and they are connected to the each to the insertion, deletion, or comment that have been added by somebody else. And the replies are threaded, so you have my original comment and then the threaded reply and then a link to the actual comment here. Moving on, the output is localizable. So what does this mean? So if I open the web help output again, go to here. For example, here it says search, so it's a static word in English. If I go to the introduction topic, here it says figure and here it says table. So there are static texts which are localized in various languages. Because the data text is of course translated in various languages, but you also need to take care and localize the static texts. And for the index page, so how do you have the static text translated in German, for example? You go and open a German project, meaning that it's a data map for a German documentation, and in the data map you have XML lang DE, And this XML lang is also specified on every topic in the publication. So every topic specifies the language in which it appears. And then let's publish it and find out how the web responsive looks like. So signaling on each topic on the main data map and submaps that you want the data content is a certain language, this signal will be used by the web author to turn the static text to the proper language. And then again, static text here saying that 25 documents were found, and so on. You can add support for other languages. So we support, I think, English, German, Japanese, and French. But you can add support to the web help output for other languages for which you want to have the static text translated correctly. So we have a topic in our user's manual, which again speaks about localization and so on. We also have some support for right to left languages like Hebrew, Arabic. So just setting the XML lang attribute on the data map on the topics will make the table of contents, for example, go to the right hand side of the screen. So in a way rotate everything. So as I told you already, the web help can be used offline with your own application, and it's also context sensitive. What does this mean? So by default, each data topic has an ID. For example, this topic has ID introduction. And once I publish, the web help output generates an XML localization file. So it generates a file which maps a help ID to an HTML document which is its equivalent. And by default, if I have IDs on my topics, the IDs will appear in this XML document. It's called the Context Help Map XML. So if an application is using our web help system, the application will use the help IDs to find out where the topics are located and open them. Like, for example, you were using this in Oxygen, and I can go to Oxygen, configure transformation scenarios, press the help button, and it takes me to the configure transformation scenarios topic located on the web. How does the application trigger the web help to go to that specific ID? It does that by issuing this command. So you tell the browser to open the index.html and append to it the context ID equals the ID of the topic, more or less. So if I go to Growing Flowers, I want to go to Introduction. So index.html, context ID, Introduction. And it took me to the introduction topic because it has that mapping that I told you about. How else can you specify the IDs? Sometimes the topic IDs are not unique. So there is a special element called, I think, application ID. It's described somewhere in our documentation. So it's called resource ID. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in the prologue of the task, for example, you say resource ID, application name, this is not important, but the application ID is important. So you can define one or two or more IDs for the same topic, and then have the application open the IDs, and then the Oxygen Web Help will map the ID to the HTML document and load the proper HTML content. This is important because you may need to change the name of a topic at some point and change the name of the HTML. But the ID remains forever, so the application works with IDs, and then as a technical writer you can rename files at your will without worrying that you will break the application's link to the proper web help output.
Does this mean that an application has to hard code these IDs?
An application can read the IDs from the XML file that we generate. So Oxygen generates this file in its output folder. So the application loads the XML in memory, and then it has all the IDs mapped to HTMLs. But the application needs to hard code the IDs to various user interface buttons and dialogues, and say this dialog needs to point to this ID,
mm-hmm.
and this dialog to the other ID. So yeah, the application will need to have some mapping between user interface items and IDs.
Within the application.
Yes. Or maybe load them from some other kind of XML configuration file. You can decide to publish web help with feedback. So you have a transformation scenario to publish web help responsive with feedback, meaning that at the end of each topic you get a feedback section allowing people to contribute. For this right now you need a MySQL server on your side, so you need to host the database for the feedback engine. If you want to see an example, you can see it here. So in the Oxygen user's manual is published as web help with feedback, and at the end of each topic you have an add new comment, and I can either add the comment as anonymous, meaning that my comment is waiting for approval because I haven't logged in, so the system doesn't trust me, or I can log in to the system and maybe I can approve, and I'm an administrator, so I can approve or edit the anonymous comment or delete it, or I can add my own comment, and then the comment is added with my username. What else can I do as an administrator? So not all users are administrators, but as an admin I can go to the administrator control panel and see all the registered users, maybe ban them, see all the pending users, people who want to register to the system but are new to the system, and I need to manually approve those people. I may need to export all the comments made by people in some other database, view all posts, remove posts from the files, and so on. And also I get to decide, each web help output has its own version. For example, this is web help output for Oxygen version 20.1. I get to decide at some point what will happen when I release the new web help for Oxygen 21. Will the comments be automatically migrated, or will they disappear and start fresh because I have considered that I have addressed all those comments? And this commenting system really works. We have people commenting in our documentation, asking various questions and so on. So you get to build a community this way, to answer questions, to make your documentation better by getting feedback from people. When I'm publishing web help with feedback, I have here the templates folder where I can choose between multiple user interface templates already created. So each template comes with its own CSS and its own way of rendering the content. I can either publish as style, as I showed you, or as a tree. And I can just choose from one of the predefined templates and publish, and my choice will be used in the documentation. But I can also start from one of the predefined templates and create my own publishing template. So this is a green template, and it shows the table of contents directly on the main page, and again the main menu here. So let me show you how publishing template looks like. So resources, templates. So this is a folder for a publishing template, and it has a special XML file defining the name of the publishing template, its description, some labels which are used in the user interface to be able to filter templates, a preview image which appears in the user interface, the parameters which will be used for transformation. So I can state when the publishing is using this template, always set these parameters in the output, and the CSSs which will be automatically copied and linked in the output folder. Maybe a logo for the entire web help system, and maybe some other files like the logo file, which will be automatically copied and included in the output. Once I have such a folder, I can go to Oxygen, edit the publishing template, and choose a custom publishing template. And if I get to this, workspace, I can choose the custom XML file from the publishing template, resources, and templates, space exploration. I choose this XML, and now I have it here. So that XML file, the configuration, added this small preview, and now I can choose the space exploration publishing template and use it. Once I have this folder created, I can zip it and use it from the command line to publish consistently my output. You see the logo, this here, the fonts specified in the CSS, and so on. So I can more or less take this folder, zip, and then share it with my colleagues, with somebody else. I can even give it as an example so somebody else to start their own publishing template. You can embed Facebook, Twitter, or Google Analytics in the pages, and we have a topic in our user's manual explaining to you how to add the Facebook like button on each HTML page, to add the Google Plus button, tweet button, and so on. So they are just small JavaScript or HTML pieces of content which can be added via parameters to the footer of each of your generated topic. We have special parameters which allow integration between web help and online editing tools like our web author, and this is shown in our documentation. So just by setting a special parameter when publishing the data content, you get this edit online link here. You click it, and Oxygen takes you to an equivalent, which is the data content from which the HTML content was generated. So if you have your repository on GitHub or on GitLab and so on, you can add these edit online features to each of the generated HTML pages. This is useful when you have your documentation generated on the intranet, on your own server, and you want reviewers to look at the documentation and read the HTML, and then click edit online, and then give you feedback directly on the data content. Make changes, and then commit to, for example, to GitHub. So this is an integration between the HTML content and a web editing tool, which can be done again with our web help output. You can automate the creation of web help also on the server side. So we have a special licensing for Oxygen Web Help, which can be bought, and then you can produce automatically the content on the server. For example, we have a Jenkins open source server which each night produces the documentation, and then in the morning we have the documentation available for review. So we don't produce the documentation manually from Oxygen, we produce it from a server. And we thought and we planned that the WebHelp documentation is accessible to people who may be blind, so we tested it with the narrators and text-to-speech recognition to see that the focus properly moves to the documentation, that they can hear the proper text when they are moving around in the documentation. We also added a 508 compliant theme for reduced vision. So we have a theme which complies. It's called Cobalt theme, and it complies with the 508 standard, meaning that it has the right color for people with reduced visibility to read. It has larger fonts, larger chromatic separation between the foregrounds and the backgrounds, and so on. Moving up to the PDF, because it's quite easy to customize HTML with CSS, we also wanted to add this possibility to customize the PDF output using CSS. So we added these new plugins which can be used to convert data to PDF based on HTML5 or CSS, or directly with data and CSS. We have an engine called Chemistry which is embedded in Oxygen, and then you can publish to PDF and use that CSS style sheets to generate the PDF for you. And you have lots of control using CSS over how the PDF will look like. So this is what a PDF generated from data with CSS, table of contents, images, index page at the end, working links between topics, and so on. So instead of using the default PDF output bundle with the Data Open Toolkit engine, we added these new plugins because they are quite very easy to customize. So what can you do? You can customize the front page, table of contents, you have headers and footers. You can change the font size and family, you can even use Google fonts. So you may have a CSS which says that, for example, import a Google font and then say that on the section title you want to have a certain font family, the font which was dynamically loaded, and then you may publish and say that publish to using data and CSS, and refer to this custom CSS which comes as a separate layer, and then when publishing the custom CSS will be used for the production of the PDF, and this is a way to change the font size on various data elements. Let's see if we have a section here. Yeah, so I've changed the titles of these sections from the dynamically loaded font. What else can you do with CSS? So using Google fonts, you can specify the page margins, say at page, and then add paddings to the page. Specify the size of the page, US letter, A4, A5, directly from the CSS. Everything is done with CSS. You can create a new page style, may for example called table landscape, and then say that the data table which has the attribute orientation landscape should be rendered in the landscape table, in the landscape page, meaning that when you produce a PDF, certain tables will be rotated and shown in the landscape landscape pages. You may need from the CSS to avoid breaking pages. Say that you want to avoid breaking the page between the title and the rest of the content. you want to avoid breaking inside the table row. If the row is large, you want to avoid breaking the content on separate pages. You want to avoid breaking a figure. You don't want page breaks between the title of the figure and the image. And most of this is already implemented, so you do not need to write the CSS for it. If you're using page mirroring, if you're publishing the PDF and you want on odd pages to have the footer on the right and on even pages to have the footer on the left side of the page, you may need to define various different margins for the left and the right page for printing the PDF.
Yes. It's also possible to mix page sizes in one PDF file, say A4, A4 portrait, and then A3 landscape?
Yes, it should work.
Okay. You don't have to show. Mm-hmm.
Generate some static content in the headers. Define the front page. For example, if I want to say that, in my front page, I want this background image. So I said page front page. And I define the pages having the background image an SVG and maybe background size and position, and then I publish, and the published output should set the background image to my front page. What else? The table of contents can be customized via the CSS. Front matter and back matter pages, image handling. Yeah, so this is my front page right now. The SVG is now part of my first page. Tables, table borders, lists and links, and what more? Hyphenation. On a table entry, you say hyphens auto, and if the language is in German, the German dictionary will be used in order to determine very long words, how they split, in order to fit in the table cell. Or if the language is set to English, you have the English hyphenator. We also have our own hyphenator trying to split words where they have camel casing, because sometimes you have very large parameters, you have parameters with large names. Support for multiple languages, like you may say that if a data node is it has a language German, use the German translation for it. But this is already taken care of, so just changing the language and publishing to PDF will show the static text appropriately for notes and images and so on. And say if the direction is right to left, you change the direction in the PDF for Arabic and Hebrew. We have Oxygen specific CSS extensions to, for example, you can match a data element and use the oxyxpath expression to count, for example, all the words in the section which is published in the PDF. So using oxyxpath on a certain element, you can gather content from other elements in the publication. What more? You can add metadata to your PDF. We have special extensions so that when you say page, you have PDF properties in the Adobe Reader, you see a table with properties, so you can add metadata to it. You can embed MathML and SVG equations in the PDF. Again, show the track changes. I showed you about hyphenation and multiple language. We have a topic about making your PDFs accessible for people who are blind. It's more or less showing you all the data features, like you should use larger fonts, you should use the alternate element, and so on. So if you want to make your PDFs accessible, you should read that. And the same publishing template used for web help can also be used for PDF output. So the same CSS, if it's properly constructed, can go and feed the PDF output and have that style in the PDF. So, what are your questions? Have you used our web help and PDF based on CSS? Maybe I made you curious. Yes, Frank.
I've not yet used the web help, But I would like to use it as a substitute for another DataOpen2 plugin I'm using. But this would require that I make considerable adjustments to the layout.
Mm-hmm.
For example, showing a more or less a tri-pane window with a table of contents
mm-hmm.
on the left and so on. Not just about mm-hmm. changing, it's not just about changing colors and so on. Can I make great substantial adjustments to the layout?
We have an older webhelp called DataMap Webhelp Classic, which may be suitable for you, but you can also make those adjustments if you want to. The webhelp output is quite customizable, the responsive webhelp. Yeah, so this is the classic webhelp.
But it should be
it's
responsive type-paid. As well. The other
no, the classic is not responsive.
Yeah, I mean, what I'm trying to do is to make a responsive webhelp, but which more or less looks like
the classic
other one.
Yeah, you have certain parameters for this, and you also can customize lots of aspects in the web responsive. If you drop us an email and tell us that you want to make the responsive look like the classic, we could try to
mm-hmm.
to help.
I can show you examples.
Yes.
How it should look like.
Do you have any other questions for me?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes.
Is this whole functionality available in just the Oxygen Editor package, or any additional tools have to be added?
So it's available out of the box in Oxygen XML Editor and XML Author. And it can be added without, so publishing for Oxygen, it's free, both the webhelp and the PDF. If you want to automate and move everything to a server,
mm-hmm.
you need to pay a server-side license. Other questions? Okay, thanks for attending.